Today we're going to talk about how we can make our computer, our CPU, run more than one process at a time. We looked at the other side of this just before Christmas, which is how we can have many CPUs run one program. What we want to look at today is how we can have one CPU appear to run many programs at the same time. We interrupt this program to bring you... How do we get our operating systems to allow more than one program, or as the operating system parlance is, process, run on the CPU at one time? Now, obviously we can't, but we can use a technique called multiprogramming, or as it's commonly referred to in the sort of non-computer science world, multitasking, to simulate that. Effectively, what we're doing is switching between one process and another very, very quickly. And the reason we can do this is because if we think about how a program runs, some of the time it is running one instruction, then the next, and then the next, and the next in sequence after each other. But a lot of the time, the programs often, particularly interactive programs, ones we use, aren't actually doing anything. They may be waiting for a network packet. They may be waiting for a key to be pressed or the mouse to click on a button. They may have just asked the operating system to load a file from disk. They may have just asked the operating system to print out Hello World. And so we can use that fact that actually these programs are waiting for the operating system to do something. And the operating system is actually waiting in many cases for the hardware. I mean, if we're waiting for a network packet, we're waiting for the hardware to send it to us, or waiting for another machine to send it to us. So actually the CPU is not doing anything useful. And what we can do is attempt to say, well, okay, this program's not doing anything useful at this point. Let's let something else that can run, run at that point. So to start a process, the operating system needs to load from the storage system the code and the data for the program into the computer's memory. Once this is done, we can start the process. And the operating system does that effectively by just setting a few bits of state within the operating system to the right values. And then we can just jump to that address in memory where we loaded that program. At this point, the CPU is only executing the process, me, and the operating system is frozen. Now the CPU will keep executing the process forever unless it's told to do otherwise. Now either by an external interrupt, interrupting the CPU, or by me, the process, making a request to the OS. So if I were to ask the OS to print out Hello World, I'd call the OS, at which point control is passed back to the OS, which can then handle that request. Afterwards, the OS has done the request, can pass back control to the process, and things continue. The program can run and run, occasionally making calls to the OS. At which point, control is passed back to the operating system, and then back to the process to do more calculation before passing control back to the OS when the process wants something else to happen. However, the operating system doesn't need to hand control back to the same process. There's nothing actually stopping us loading a different program's code and data, again from storage, into memory as well. And then we can start that program instead by returning to its code start address. Welcome to Computerphile's first unboxing video. I've got here the Raspberry Pi 4 computer, and we're going to open this and have a look at how this works. To do that, we're going to need to cut it open. Nobody's actually got the knife module loaded in. Operating system, could you load the knife DLL for me? And then the OS is back in control, and it can then pass control not back to the new process, but back to the original process, which continues as if nothing had happened. It's oblivious to the fact that there's this other process running. From my point of view, I asked the OS to do something. It did it, and it handed back control to me. I'm completely unaware that there's any other process running on the system. So we're going to have the operating system switch between the different processes. And to do that, we need to be able to do three things. The first is we actually need to physically switch from one process running to another. Now, at some level, this is straightforward. We just jump from one memory address to another. But we have to keep track of a few things. And so that's called context switching, and we'll look at that in detail in another video. The other thing we need to do is decide which process is going to run next. And that's called process scheduling. And again, we'll do another video on that. It's just deciding we've had this process running, which one's ready, which one are we going to actually run at this time. And the other thing is we need a model, a way of deciding which processes are available to run. And that's what we're going to look at today. So we're going to have this idea that we're going to have many programs running, many processes running, and we're going to switch between them. So let's look at how we might model that. So we're going to start off building up what we call the life cycle of the process. So we're going to start off by creating the process, and then it'll transition from that to what we call the running state. And if you think about it, so process is created, It then starts running on the CPU. So the operating system curse then starts running on the CPU. And then eventually it is terminated. So we can start to see how this works. So let's find a process, Jelly Baby. So the process gets created by the operating system. And as we saw in the demo, it then starts running on the CPU and it's doing things, it's calculating things. Unless it's a very boring process and it just immediately kills itself and does nothing, at some point, this process is going to want to interact with the rest of the world. It's going to call the operating system to do something. And when it does that, we model that by having another state in our system, call this blocked, and our process can transfer from the running state to the blocked state. And at that point, we know that process is still doing things, it hasn't finished. It can't run at the moment because it's waiting for something to happen, something to be printed out, some data to come over the network, whatever it is. So what we do is it stays there, and then eventually we can take it back to the running state. And so we can then have our process go back to the running state. It's printed out hello world. It now waits for a key to be pressed, so it's blocked again, and then it goes back to the running state until eventually it gets terminated. But of course, we can then start another process. And we can start to see now how we can model having more than one process, what's going on in the operating system. Because we've got that process running there, and then we can create another one. Now, obviously, it can't run at the moment because this process is running. But eventually, this process will ask for something to print it out, at which point it's blocked. And the operating system can schedule that process to be running. So this is waiting for, say, a key to be pressed on the keyboard. But this one can then run and start calculating pi to 500 decimal places or whatever it is it's doing. Now we'll get to a point where either this process will decide it, say, we need to print something else, at which point it can then become blocked as well. Or this process will get the key that's been waiting for from the keyboard, in which case it's ready to start running again. So actually we don't translate directly from blocked to running. We actually have a state called runnable. And we use that to keep track of processes that can run, but can't run at the current time. So this one's running, this one can run, but it's not ready. And let's create another one as well. So eventually this one starts saving something out to disk, so it's got to wait for that to finish. And now we can either schedule this one to be running, or that one could be scheduled to be running, and that one could wait there. But let's put that one on there, we'll have the green process running. This one gets the data saved to disk, and so that one is now also runnable. And then this one, let's wait for some network packet, it's an HTTP server, say, and we can schedule one of these back on here. Now, as should be obvious, you can only ever have one process or running at a time, or technically one per CPU, but you can have as many as you like in the runnable state, and you can have as many in the block state, and you can follow the transitions between the different things to model the process. And this works fine because eventually the process is, can then finish and complete.
Can you go straight to terminate from, say, runnable or anything? Or do you have to go back to
the... Well, so the program, that's a good question. If you're here, could you go straight to terminate? Yes and no. This process could be terminated directly by the operating system, something outside it says, I want to kill this process, in which case it gets terminated and cleared up. But for it to stop itself, it has to be running on the CPU to execute the code to say that it's finished. So we can have many in this state, but only one running on there.
But then you could have another CPU come in, take that there, and then terminate.
Yeah. one of my processes is missing.
Oh dear, I just wanted a jelly maybe.
Yeah, I'll need another process or two. But okay, so this works. Let's have a running process. We move things around. But say this process here, something goes wrong. You've written a bit of code and it gets stuck in an infinite loop. Well, we've now got a problem. The operating system, the way we've designed it, can only switch when one of these processes hands control to it. It calls the operating system. That's what we built. It's what we call a cooperative multitasking system because we require the processes to cooperate. They have to hand control back to the to the operating system at some point. And operating systems like the original Mac OS, operating systems like Windows 3.1, they worked in this sort of fashion. They could run many programs at the same time, but they required them to pass control back to the operating system regularly, which a GUI program will do because of the way they work. But if they ever did some long calculations, say ray tracing or something, you could often get the system freeze if it was badly written software. You'd have to call the operating system occasionally to hand control back. But there is another way we can do it. We can build what's called a preemptive multitasking operating system. And what happens here is that the operating system says, okay, I know I can switch control when you've moved between states, when you've passed control to me, because I can then bring that one in. But what I'll do is I'll say, I'm going to regularly look at what's running and change the process. And to do that, we have another, let me just redraw this diagram before we do that. So at this point, if this process is running for a long time, then the operating system can't change it because its code's not running. We're reliant on this actually making a call to the operating system. Now, the way we get around that is that a modern operating system like Unix, like Windows NT, and so on, what they do is they say, actually, as well as switching processes when they call the operating system, we will let the operating system switch the process automatically. And the way we do that is two things. First, we provide a mechanism for the operating system to regain control regularly from the process, regardless of them doing it. And the way we do that is we have an external interrupt which fires, say, every 200th of a second, every 1,000th of a second, whatever you want it to be, differs from computer to computer. So every 200th of a second, this external timer interrupts the CPU, and that passes control to the operating system. And now the operating system's back in control, and it can switch processes. It can say, well, okay, this process has now had enough time on the CPU. We shall take that off and put a different one on. And the way it does that is that we extend this model to allow us to move process, not just from blocked into being ready to runnable, but from running into the runnable state, so that we can bring another process in. And what will happen is that every time we switch processes, we move one from running into runnable, or back into running, or occasionally that one will then call the operating system, and can we move one in like that. So we get them switching as the regular interrupts are happening between the two and so on. It's like having the two Steves talking about different things, and we can keep them running until they finish and we get to murder them. And what's happening? We've talked about the key down event, the key up, mouse click events. We probably wouldn't get one when the mouse is moved. If you think about it, as the mouse is being moved, you'll get lots and lots of events, most of which you're not interested in. You're probably only interested when a button's pressed, or so on. The only times perhaps that's different is if perhaps you